happening in the 21st century right now, and they put out this amazing policy platform yes. 2 months ago, y'all, and I don't know if anyone in this room has read it, but please read it. It matters so much for rural America. They're asking for an end to fossil fuel extraction. They're asking for universal internet access for everyone. I mean, like, so many things that you're like, oh, this is just about, like, black urban people. Like, it's not, y'all. And so I think there's real questions we have to ask ourselves in rural communities about what are the similarities we have with people, but what are some of the differences, and how do we really understand that relationships are two-way streets. And that it's not okay to just sit in our like tiny white community and say like, well, we don't know how to deal with X, Y, and Z because we're just here. But to really reach out and realize that people are making substantial arm links out to us, and it's up to us to return. And I specifically think about it and have been trying my best as a young person to learn more about what that specifically means for Native sovereignty, and that Indian country is not the same as rural America. and we need to talk about that as a rural group, whatever that means. So anyway, I just wanted to say those are some of my reflections over the last 24 hours. Is the work is amazing, and we got to go harder, and we got to go deeper, and we really need to reach out to each other in some more thoughtful ways. So thank you all. Very happy to be here.
Yeah.
Well, good afternoon. My name is Ryan Taylor. I'm one of two guys here with a cowboy hat on. I'm the only guy from North Dakota, and what brought me here is a long dirt road, and I live on the end of a long dirt road south of Towner, North Dakota most of the time, 16 miles between me and the town of 533 people. I kind of think of a long dirt road as an analogy that is obviously rural, but it's one that's kind of guided my life up to this point. I was a columnist for 21 years, writing a column called Cowboy Logic. And part of what I did there was bring stories about the life at the end of that dirt road to folks who lived on the ends of dirt roads all across the western U.S. and western Canada, in a half dozen major ag magazines. I had a chance to serve folks at the end of the long dirt roads when I was elected senator 3 times in my state senate. And we had a 4,000 square mile district that had 13,500 people in it. So that's pretty rural. The schools and the communities and the folks in that district had pretty distinct needs that I was proud to represent. I raising kids, cattle, and horses at the end of that long dirt road. And as of last August, received the appointment to be the state director for USDA Rural Development. And you know what rural development does? They help out folks at the ends of long dirt roads. We financed the fiber optic cable that came along my dirt road and brought gigabit capable speed internet to my home in Gorman Township, which has 6 families and 36 square miles. That's pretty cool. We make sure the hospital on the other end of that dirt road is modern and capable and well financed to satisfy folks' needs. And that we have things in that community that make us proud to live there. So, you know, my mom was an artist and a fiddler and a coyote trapper. Those aren't 3 things that are often put together. My dad was a cowboy, but that appreciation for the arts is probably what brings me here as much as anything. And North Dakota is resource dependent. It's an oil and an ag state. Number 3 behind that is tourism. And so you get tied to commodities and you're all of a sudden oil's below $50 a barrel and the sky is falling. And wheat goes down and corn goes down and cattle go down and the sky is falling. It literally is on the economy. So how do you diversify that? And I think with our work at rural development, we're about improving quality of life and increasing economic opportunities. And we know that gets beyond the commodities because commodity production will usually do what it's going to do. But how do you add value beyond that? How do you expand beyond that? And I think that's where the opportunities are that I want to be a part of. Maybe a takeaway, since I'm a storyteller and wrote stories for 21 years, I appreciated the storytelling session with the heart and soul folks. And so I think all of us gathered here will think about not what we don't have, but what we do have, right? And if we're living at the end of that dirt road, it's a conscious decision. We're not just stuck there. We're there because we want to be there, right? And we're there because we have something that keeps us there. And those were the questions that struck me in the storytelling session is not just storytelling for the sake of telling a story or entertainment, which is what I've done a lot of my life, but also to bring communities together. Why do you live where you do? What do you have that you're most proud of, right? What's your biggest concern? And I know one of the things that I'm most proud of is also my greatest concern, because if we get together to work cattle on our place, we've got 30 people there that we feed from around the neighborhood. So we've got a community of folks that care more about their neighbors than they care about getting the neighbor's land. And it's a pretty competitive business, where in a lot of places it's about glomming on to what your neighbor's got so you can be bigger and more efficient and produce more and make more, right? But we still care enough about each other that we all go help each other. And it's a tremendous day. It's my favorite day of the year. My biggest concern is that we might lose that, right? So it's good to be here today to be a part of that culture and part of this event.
Hi, my name is Michael Rode. I come from Baltimore originally. I come from a Russian Jewish family. I come from Quaker school. I come from a lot of TV. And I come from a lot of travel, having spent most of my adult life working in different communities around the nation as an artist. And I'm here today as the founding artist and the executive director of the Center for Performance and Civic Practice, which is a 5-year-old national resource for artists and communities working together to build civic equity, health, and capacity. And we work at the intersection of arts and community workers and social change makers in communities around the nation. I used to say the lower 48, but we're doing a bunch of work in Alaska of late, so the lower 48 and. And I also am the founding artistic director of Sojourn Theater, which is a 17-year-old ensemble-based theater company. And we make original work. And I'm really listening to the three of you talk about your work, thinking about story, and the things that have been on my mind today and on my mind lately as I thought about this conversation was the condition of empathy and the action of listening. And as we are all amidst the current landscape of public discourse and political tumult, it seems, and I know, I've been told by my parents and my grandparents and a long time ago, a great-grandparent, many of whom I just mentioned who were not born here, that everyone always thinks that they're in the most tumultuous time. That everyone always thinks that their story is most laden with crisis. That everyone always thinks that folks have never listened as much as they don't listen today. I find it hard to believe, as a 49-year-old man, that there have been a lot of times in the last couple hundred years of how things have been going here that listening has been as poor as today. But then again, there are many people we can talk to in this room and elsewhere who would say, no, that is not new. A long history of not listening here and in a lot of other places. So I am interested in our conversations here about how we are all, through the varied projects that we take on and the varied initiatives we support and the various missions and agendas of change that we spend our blood and sweat and energy on, how we are not only making space to build the capacity for listening in spaces where it is perhaps rare and difficult, but how we are also committed to transformation of self in the process of working on listening. I don't know how many of you have this experience, but a lot of my work as an artist and a community worker has to do with trying to build capacity and space, and occasionally at home, the person that I live with, and my wife and the co-parent of our children will say to me, "Don't you work on listening a lot?" So I do. She says, "So let's bring some of that home." And I have been thinking about that a lot, from again, commitment to change equity and inclusion in all aspects of our work, particularly working on the practice of partnership, which is what we spend a lot of our time doing in Alaska a few weeks ago, working with the housing authority and community partners and artists on how do we make space for ethical, collaborative, co-design and co-creation in rural and urban contexts that's going to be meaningful, resident-driven, creative, innovative, and change-making. So I'm excited to be in the room with you, learning about that, offering a little bit of experience on that, and hopefully learning how to listen better.
Wow, right?
Pretty
cool.
Yeah.
I'm the Executive Director of Region 5 Development Commission in Central Minnesota, where I serve and work and play. I'm actually foremost a mother of three adult children and a grandmother of one grandbaby, and proudly the wife of my partner of 32 years. And that is most important. And he will tell you the thing that keeps Cheryl Hills motivated and moving every day is the fact that I have to have my hands in the dirt at least once a week to be whole and to have my mental health sane. So I think that's who I am. That's where I come from. What brings me here is the journey that we started in Central Minnesota around building a resilient region about 5 years ago. And it has been a very interesting journey on how to live up to and hold our values of people in that five-county area that is economic prosperity, that truly adheres to environmental stewardship and really pays attention to our values around quality of life for all people. And I know that's lip service a lot, but it is work that has engaged us into a lot of new relationships that's taken us to the places like this, with colleague brothers and sisters as yourselves that are doing work in the space of placemaking and involvement of our next generations and in ways that value creative thinkers. So we're on the beginning of what I call the placemaking journey in Central Minnesota with a lot of work ahead of us, frankly. So what I'm holding, Eric, to answer your third question is so much gratitude. When I look around this room and I see these people and I've been listening to these sessions all day, and the expertise you hear on this panel, it is easy to walk away from summits like this and feel very intimidated and go back home and say, holy shit, I gotta walk away today. Like, oh my God, there's just not enough time in the day to do what I gotta do to make things better for the people that I care about in our region. Yet, I look around and go, I got a lot of brothers and sisters here that can help me figure this out. I'm not alone. And that's gratifying, and I'm very humbled by that and very appreciative. So thank you all for being here. And I think we should dive right into some questions, Eric. What do you think?
That's great. Yeah, I think we should dive into questions. Thank you, Cheryl. I just want to thank the panel. So I want to actually also thank Matthew and folks from Marla Rule who put this together, because in some ways this panel is representative of what we're talking about, right? You got folks that are really rooted in the arts, like Michael and Aiden Appleshop and the work that they all do, but also that work is also about community, right? You got folks that are coming in from rural development and from the economic development point of view, right? You got Jeremy as an intermediary kind of supporting individual artists, so they're the driver, right? Art is made by artists, right? So I just want to kind of acknowledge that and just kind of recognize that, like, this is what we're talking about, y'all, like right here, these people, right? I also want to just reflect on some of what I heard as I've given y'all time to think about who wants to raise their hand first to, like, come up and say hello. But you know, this notion of wanting, number one, we're not alone in this work, it's about relationships, but this idea of how do we transform ourselves, right? It starts with us, and this notion of listening, right? I think Aidy talked also about this relationships being two-way streets, right? And I was listening to a conversation the other day, and Jamie Bennett's here in the house from Art Place. I was in a conversation with him, and he talked to me the other day. We talked a lot about how we want to give voice to the voiceless, and he was saying that, well, maybe we need to actually be given ears to the earless. Right? Because it's there's a lot of talking, but there needs to be more listening, right? And so I just want to kind of underscore that. And this idea of us really trying to think about the new systems that are needed as we move forward, right? The new systems to really get us to the better place in the 21st century, how we build on things like community identity, how we meet people where they're at, Jeremy, what you're saying, right? Meeting people where they're at, I think, is so important. And then the last point I was going to make is what Ryan said about And what is it we love about the places where we live? What's at the end of that long, dirt road? Because at the end of the day, you know, it is about love, right? It's about love for our place, about love for our communities, about love for our families. That's why we do this work. So with that, I would love to, if I may have a mic, who would like to, who has a question or a comment that they want to share with the group? And if you could give your name and where you're from, it'd be awesome.
Okay. My name is Christine Gauvet from Central Virginia, Charlottesville. And you just summed things up beautifully. I guess what I would ask the panelists, you know, I've been listening a lot today, and what do you see, I don't know how to easily frame this, but in terms of continuing to learn from and support one another moving forward, what do you see as the greatest opportunities and challenges that we as a group of people can continue to do to support one another, learn from one another, and to kind of create that rising tide for rural communities, you know, across the nation?
There is a mic under the chair, and if you would be willing to use that one. I'm not sure who wants to jump in first, but.
Yeah.
So what do we need to continue to do to really help ensure that as the tide rises, we're making sure the tide rises and that rural communities are benefiting from that.
Well, to support one another, supporting one another, I think, and continuing as, you know, beyond individual communities.
Who wants to jump in? Someone? Andy, you hold the mic.
I think it'll kind of vary a little bit, but maybe there will be opportunities for us all to continue to work together, and I think as the Pioneer Collective folks talked about, we're not all millennials here probably, but to be on the platforms that millennials are, which hopefully we should all be on, and maintain that relationship together, to hold each other up. And I told this when I was on call with Cheryl the other day, so since I've got young children, 8, 10, and 12, I relate everything to a children's book. And the book about filling your bucket, right? Remember the book where everyone's got a bucket above their head, and when you're saying mean things to each other, it's emptying. And if you're building them up, the bucket fills back up, and you can see that bucket over everyone's head. I think maybe in a smaller sense than the whole group, and maybe it won't connect to Charlottesville and Virginia, but for me, having just designated a promise zone in North Dakota with the Turtle Mountain Band of Chippewa and the Spirit Lake Dakota, that I'm going to definitely work with the folks that I've met here that have the other promise zones and are using arts to build economic opportunity in promise zones where there's persistent poverty, and it's Kentucky and South Carolina, and places that I don't go to every day. But maybe the advice would be to seek out and build these relationships here. Maybe we'll get together again in a year or 2 years, and we can always contact on those platforms that are out there. So.
If I could just add to that, I actually think that for me, I would say to Matthew during the break, we're getting ready for this, it's like, we have tried to pack so much into this day because we just don't do this enough, right? And so I'd actually say that this is a great opportunity, but this is a first installment in some ways of exactly that. How do we start to get to know each other and start to build those relationships? The other thing I'd say is that for me personally, I'm walking away with a pile of cards in my pocket, right? And I would encourage each of you, if you don't come away from this thing with like three or four new folks, I would say who said that going to conferences is kind of like, you know, you meet people and you take these little rocks away, you know, like new contacts, right? And you can only take so many rocks home, but you better be taking at least 2, 3, 4, 5 rocks home with you. Folks that you're going to follow up with, they're going to email, they're going to talk to you, and really rely on, as Cheryl said, knowing that we're brothers and sisters in this work, right? That we're all in this together. So, and there's a question here in the back here.
Do you want any of us to?
Go ahead.
It's really quick. We have found that when communities of practice in geographic regions are trying to find different ways to come together over time and build coalitions of practice or support, that there's kind of like, it seems that there are three main things that bring different personalities or organizations to the table, and the sort of sweet spot is figuring out how to let all three of those things coexist in a network. And one of them is people come together to learn. People come together to talk about problems and challenges and get into problem-solving mode, and people come together to highlight bright spots or successes. And the trick is, some people really only want to come together to problematize and problem solve. And some people only want to come together if it's a learning opportunity and so on. So how do you make spaces where either you have three tracks that people can intersect on, or how do you allow all three of those things to happen simultaneously so different folks have inroads to the process
and the possibility to develop relationships in a larger than just a couple entities at a time. So
adding to that, I think one of the things that we've also thought about is along the lines of those three tracks is thinking about who's at the table and who else might care about the issues that we're talking about and who else should be at that table. And that goes back to thinking about our own worldviews and our own biases and where we come from and who else might have a different view that can add diversity and, frankly, innovation to solve some of the issues and to address some of the conversations. And I think not only addressing how people, what they want to do when they come together, but that ecosystem is can be sustained and create great work when there are those diverse views at the table, and certainly when those we're trying to benefit and impact are there.
Hi, thanks. Great panel. I'm Sam Cordes from Wrigleyville, Illinois. Ada talked about the importance of community identity. Cheryl, you work in a fairly large geographical space, much more regional. There can be tension between individual community identity and that larger region. Can two of you or any of you make a comment on how that tension can be overcome in general, using the arts in particular, whatever?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, community can get used in a lot of ways, right? I know an older woman who specifically talks about community of place, right? So it's a very place-specific community, so it's not around a cultural context or something racially or some identity thing. It's about where you live. So for instance, when I think a lot about the community identity of my region, it is based around the people who have come in and out of that physical landscape, the Appalachian region. And when I think about what our cultural identity is, it's not static. Right, I think one of the things that I feel like is one of the biggest tension points is people feeling like this is the culture, like this is what we are, and there's no straying from that. Whereas we understand most cultural identities come from a long array of people and influence and the way that things meld or don't meld together, and that we're always creating culture, right? That we, like for instance, at Appalachian, we talk a lot about cultural sustainability, that it's not captured in a jar, we're not putting that dead butterfly on a chart so we can understand the biological whatever, that we are a part of helping create and understand that, for instance, right now in Appalachia, one of the most lively cultural events are punk rock shows. It's not the banjo and the fiddle. So, you know, it's like, I think, I guess I just want to wriggle out of that question a little bit and say, yes, I think there can be community and regional conflicts, and yet I think we need to be a little more thoughtful about culture as an active thing that is changing, and that we also have to deeply understand the roots of it and where it comes from. And I think there's been a lot of amazing panels, but another thing I've been taking away a lot is that erasure of who we are and where we come from. Being a key thread of also what happens in small towns and rural areas as people leave, you don't know where your people went and where they came from. So anyway, I guess I didn't exactly answer the question, but that's my take on it. I don't know if anyone else.
Yeah, Jeremy, that never happens in Indian country, does it?
Almost never. Yeah. It does actually happen a lot. And so,
I'm gonna admit something. Confession. I'm a very territorial, and I'm very kind of passionate about the work that I do. And most recently, there was an organization that kind of has traditionally done financial lending on a national level, and is kind of working within the same sector as First Peoples Fund as in arts now. And initially, the ego kind of took over, and like, what are they doing in my sector? They're in my sandbox. And it was really hard for me to kind of say, you know, but after evaluating things and talking with them, you know, they bring a whole different skill set to the work that we're not bringing, and we have already been doing something amazing and great within our own communities, but it all impacts the community in a positive, healthy way. And for me to really kind of wanting to take a needing to take a knee and saying, you know what, this organization really has something to offer that's really great and benefits us holistically, not just First Peoples funding the work that we do, but the community is going to, and the communities across the region are going to do that. That was something that you know, really had to accept, I guess, on a personal level and professional level as well. I don't know if that answers the question, but.
Well, it sure is interesting.
Yeah.
I really appreciate you sharing that. It's difficult.
I'll maybe just tack on something there because it was brought up about you know, tribal nations and the other folks say in North Dakota where we have five tribal nations and the rest of us can live 6 miles away, and I can think of folks I served in political life with that had never traveled to a tribal nation in North Dakota, and they're North Dakotans, and it just blew my mind. And so one of the projects we recently helped fund with community facility loan and grant, and Northwest Area Foundation was involved, and the Tribal Council was involved at the Turtle Mountain, but it's a heritage center. And they happen to locate it within rock's throw from the casino. So we know that we're starting, whether, you know, we have a discussion about that, but folks are starting to come together. And now it's not just some slot machines or a blackjack table, but actually a chance to appreciate the culture that is generations deep there, and a portion of the art that can create economic opportunity, because up to 25% of that facility can be used for retail purposes and business. So I think whether we travel outside of the U.S., we know that handshake diplomacy and relationships come from a lot of different ways, but you're right, I think it can come from the arts, and when we can help fund a project like that, that's worthwhile, along with the music that takes place that brings people together. That's a way to break down barriers.
Thanks, Sam, for that question. On a regional scale, it can be difficult sometimes, but I think the approach that we've taken in Central Minnesota is to say, we have a lot of commonality and opportunities in that region on a regional scale, but we don't have to do everything on a regional scale, and we don't have to lose the identity and the autonomy of our very small towns. Those small communities that value their culture and want to maintain that and don't want to be part of a micropolitan that's, you know, 50,000 people 20 miles away. They still want that culture and that autonomy, and they want the control, frankly, to stay small. And so the approach that we've taken is to say, yes, and we can think about regional strategies that address some of the challenges that we're dealing with, whether it's in the space of broadband or whether it's energy or local foods and food sovereignty. But we also can do some of those things on a regional scale, but some of those things need to be done on a localized level, and that's okay. So it isn't a one-size-fits-all. I think that's important. Our approach has also been to start, as your question indicated, around arts and culture, but it's always been with food. So for us, it's been creating culture through food and art. And so that's the marriage that we started with, because that was the common thread that a region had, was that quality of place, and that involved food and art and to create our cultural envelope. So I think, does that answer your question a little bit? Okay, thank you.
Any question? As I'm walking around, I'll just also say that if I can, part of the question for me also is this idea that we all do better when we all do better, right? And so part of it is, how do you broaden that up in conversation to recognize that, you know, hey, if my neighbor 3 miles down the road, 300 miles down the road is doing better, that actually helps me as well, right? And I think that also is, when we put that in a cultural context, we also often have this like us versus them kind of thing, right? And I think I was just in one of the breakout sessions where we were talking a little bit about how, you know, actually when there's more equity, we actually are all going to do better in the long run. So I think that's all, there's a framing part of this, I think, that is also an opportunity. So
I think my piece of the puzzle has to do with Martin Luther King said in the letter from Birmingham Jail that there's a kind of tension, dramatic social tension that's necessary for growth. And I think that's a key maybe to this listening issue. And, you know, I was noticing here some of the issues that were mentioned in some of the things I attended. You know, there was genocide mentioned, there was bus boycotts, there was, you know, racism, and, not much of the farm aspect of social attention. So, for example, a dairy farmer in the New England shot all of his cows with a shotgun, I guess, and shot himself. I don't think he felt like he was being listened to. And I'm someone who has worked on farm issues for 30 years and had a lot of people for decades saying, we want to listen to farmers, we want to listen to farmers, we want to listen to farmers, we're here to listen to farmers, we're here to listen to farmers, kind of like that, you know? And so anyway, here, just 10, 15 miles away, we had a farmer murdered his wife, so that she wouldn't know, that he murdered his banker, and then he murdered a neighbor, and then he shot himself. And I don't think he felt he was being listened to either. Just to translate that back to how I hear things. I come from a certain place. I mean, I see that here we have listened, some anyway, to Native Americans and to the Latino and so forth. I heard things. A couple of things I heard were just in this session. You know, beyond commodities is where the opportunities are. It's kind of like saying that the corn belt, wheat belt, cotton belt, dairy belt, western rangelands, isn't their biggest issues. Aren't what we want to focus on if we're doing rural art. That's filtered through my experience and my father's and my grandfather's. When I mentioned them, you know. But anyway, on another part of it, and then I'll sit down here. Everyone thinks that theirs is the most tumultuous time with the least listening, and that sounds kind of like a distancing thing, as did the commodity thing. I think it has to be objectively examined. Okay, I spent 8 years examining how people are listening to it, how are they hearing. For example, the new food movement and the environmental movement, a lot of it, what has been a 50-year social drama in Iowa and across the nation. And I think we've been erased from history. I think there's an objective reason for saying that. I'm wearing the shirt of the woman's history here that has two archives, but you can't get it online, the good stuff. You have to come to Iowa, and it's not digitalized much yet. Anyway, so tension.
I just want to say that I think, first off, the stories that you're saying are real. Like, this is happening to people all the time, every day in this country, and obviously it's not just farmers who are at the point that they don't feel like they're getting listened to and they're going to drastic measures. And so that's what I was saying earlier. Like, I literally feel like people are in really hard situations right now. And it's really hard to watch, as anyone who has an analysis, has a worldview, et cetera, it's really hard to watch the situation that I think our country has put itself in and the way that it has decided to treat its people. And I think that for me, you know, as you're speaking about the local foods movement or whatever, like for me, it's around climate change, right? It's like, as a young person, do I feel like it's better to have an environment that's hopefully going to be protected longer? Yes. What does that look like on the ground for me in my place? Looks like massive disinvestment, no jobs, no opportunity, economic collapse. Like, because I think one of the things we haven't figured out yet, and this is what I was trying to speak to before, is like, what new systems are going to be created to when we disinvest in all the current forms of energy production we have, there are ways to reinvest into the places that we're looking at because of that. And I think that's the same thing with food production in this country. I don't know it as deeply. I don't live in a place where there's massive agriculture. We have small-scale agriculture, but I think these questions are the same questions we as a people, as a community, as a country, have to figure out, and specifically within our financial structures. It's not just the government, it's the private investment world that has got to figure out when it disinvests how it's going to make sure a place that's specifically rural, small towns, Indian country, et cetera, continue to have investment when things are, when society tells us that things have to shift over here. And probably it's a good thing, those shifts. And yet, it doesn't feel like that when you're on the ground. It doesn't feel like it's a good thing. It doesn't feel like people are getting listened to. It doesn't feel like they have any chance for anything new. It feels like we're just left. And I think it's one of the biggest dichotomies within this country right now. I think it even brings to bear the founding of this country. What is the role of this country? In my opinion, it was to do what it's doing now, to continue to make as much profit as possible on whatever means that it has to make. I think these are big questions we have to wrestle with. And I think the hard part that you're bringing up is that people, individual lives, human beings are affected. Communities are affected when humans are affected. I mean, avalanches. I want to say thank you for bringing it up, and I hope we can wrestle with these questions together.
I appreciate the question, and just to talk about commodities, and as a guy who took ag econ in college, and I'm not saying that, you know, there's no opportunities in commodities, because our family's tried to make a living at that for generations. My good friend Sarah Vogel was the one who led the lawsuit of Coleman versus Block during the 80s farm crisis, when those things that are still happening, as you said, were happening at that period of time as well. In our mind, and not to, you know, put any barriers, but for the folks in Western North Dakota, they, you know, or those who produce oil, they can't control the price of oil. And OPEC makes a decision miles away, and their local economy will be subject to that. And I personally can't set the price of cattle, you know, that we sell. I can get involved in a co-op up in Oregon that directly sells to the wedge in Minneapolis, and maybe that gives me a little more control. And now working in rural development, that's maybe the place where I can make a difference. If I could make a difference on commodities, I'd darn sure do it. But where I can make a difference with the work that I've got right now is value-added producer grants and with making sure that if you're going to have vibrant agriculture, you got to have a vibrant community. So that if you're, whether you're producing commodities or whether you're producing something more value-added, you've still got a hospital that your family can depend on. You still got a daycare center if you need a place for your children. You've still got internet to connect to the rest of the world. So appreciate the question, and hopefully there wasn't any slight.
There's a question up here. Come on, one, two.
There's two questions back here.
This is sort of a follow-up to what's being said and what you were saying, Aidan. Please forgive my, I grapple with this, but I can't quite get in on the specific, articulate it. But in light of this moment of, which is not, a long moment of an agonizing transition of systemic change, it can at times become be a bit of a triage for an artist in a great way, in that, all of the artistic sensibilities can lead to creating structures or being a mediator or a communicator or being a teacher or being a fundraiser, all these things, that then the scaffolding for that very delicate, very erotic, or that very sensitive spiritual component, whatever you want to call it, that thing that relates to aliveness, which I think is needs to rival any aspect of community infrastructure, not rival it, let's say accompany it. Sorry, I'm trying to be really careful. So in thinking about this transition, which is a long-term one, so then how do we talk about the long-term while dealing with the present? How do we protect these more, for lack of a better word, esoteric components, which are so important to human evolution, like not only responses to structures that are tool-based or problem-solving, but are based on vulnerability and purpose. How do we protect that artistic part that is so crucial? And also, how do we talk about these different economies that are melding and mixing and bumping heads, these gift economies and these market economies? My name's Matthew.
Well, I just want to say that I feel like the space between what you offer and what you're saying is this question that is partly a question of these couple days, as well as being an ongoing question, which is, if an artist, when an artist engages in the kind of practices we're talking about, and the kind of attempted interventions or change work that we're talking about, what's the artist's responsibility? What's the artist's accountability? What's the artist's participation in and around human pain, in and around crisis and fear, in and around struggle of all kinds? And what is the responsibility of creative and artistic practice that moves through story and through process right in the middle of people's lives? Whether directly attempting to impact lives in collaboration with people whose lives are affected by what we're dealing with, or making the thing from a belief that the making and the thing are offering something else in collaboration with the change efforts. Responsibility, accountability, ethics, intention, all that stuff is not a panel arriving at conclusion moment, but like you very generously, and it seems with cost for a moment, brought real pain into a conversation that is suffused and filled with pain. I mean, we're talking the kind of changes that we're often using, like lots of frameworks and language around, is like people hurting. And I imagine like a lot of us in this room at different points in our families' histories have sort of had our families move through various kinds of pain, and there's very real pain right now that's at the center of the kind of issues a lot of people here are working with. So I really hope that conversation continues.
Yeah. I just wanted to affirm that what you were saying, and thank you for sharing it, and you were comparing that other people's stories were being heard more than the other.
And that's good.
Yeah, that's great. It is. And I just want to, but to your point, I think what you're saying points to the fact that we all have work to do together, right? That, so now you're feeling this pain, and many others have been feeling this pain for a long time, but let us not isolate ourselves into our pain. Let us go towards all of the people who are doing this work and have historically felt this pain and do the work together. Because if this moment's calling for anything, it's for us to not silo ourselves.
And to be responsible as we do.
Listen to that. I don't know if we can say anything after that, right? That's about it.
Eric, let's just add one quick thing. What a great moment for us to be able to use arts and culture to walk us through some of those conversations. And if not, for art to be able to depict some of these issues in different lights, in ways that we can bring them forward and talk about them, then what? So I'm really grateful that this is an opportunity for us all to address the fears that we have, look at these issues on all sorts of levels, and use art and culture as a way to do that. So this is a good day.
I just want to echo that. I also just want to say a couple of things. As we close out, we do want to end up, but just to say, you know, someone else told me that the systems that we have are designed exquisitely to get the results we're getting. when you couple that with this notion of, you know, the definition of insanity is doing the same thing and expecting different results. And the reality is that we do. We have to apply all of our creative talents. We have to work together as a family working on this. We need the vulnerability. We need to be recognizing kind of one another, seeing each other, hearing each other, and working together to try to build those new systems that we've been talking about. So hopefully today has been a great day for y'all. The last 24 hours have been kind of an installment on that. We have the rest of this evening together where we can continue these conversations, continue to kind of explore these possibilities, and obviously then we'll be together tomorrow in the morning. So I just want to thank the panelists again, and thank y'all for your time.
We're very fortunate to have Mary Slaughter with us today, who is the Poet Laureate. from Iowa. And she's going to be here today to read, and she has an actress with her, and you can see in your program what this is going to be about. But it really is how land is really the thread that binds all stories together. So we're really excited about that. It's going to take about 10 minutes for Mary to get everything set up out here. So we'll just hang out here a little bit, and please continue your conversations that you were having, and just a couple other pieces. So Mary will perform. We'll have that. We'll have time for a few questions. And then it's on to the Moose Lodge tonight for a lot of fun. We will have buses leaving from the same place today that they dropped you off and where they picked you up last night. We will have an express bus that goes directly from the Levitt Center to the Moose Lodge. We will also have buses that will go from the Levitt Center to downtown and to the Moose Lodge. So they will rotate. They'll continually rotate. So we'll get people going. And just another thing is, once you're at the Moose Lodge, if you're ready to come home, we will have buses running again, Sheraton Camp, Sheraton, out to the Moose Lodge, Sheraton Camp. And the last bus will leave to the camp at 11 o'clock. So just to let you know, and I'll remind you that again, but I just wanted to give you that information. But that's where we're at now. We're going to take about 10 minutes to get this stage set up. So continue your conversations. And again, thank you for everybody participating and hanging in today.
Funny community, but ultimately, I think that those who are closest to the center really have
sorry. Yeah.
wonderful. So, with no further ado, because I've only had one day, and I know I told you a little bit about the poet laureate earlier, I wanted to introduce Mary Swander, who is the poet laureate from Iowa. So I'm just going to bring you right up. I gave you a little intro before you came in, Mary. So thank you for your patience and getting us through this, and we'll let you do a little introduction and go right in.
There is a swath of land in the United States as big as the original Louisiana Purchase that is going to change hands in the next 10 years. It adds up to over 2 million acres. And a couple of years ago, Practical Farmers of Iowa, a conservation-minded farming organization, commissioned me to write a play about farmland transition. And what you're going to see is Map of My Kingdom, starring Maria Orhees, which has been touring now for 2 years all throughout the Midwest in farmers' barns to the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago to the USDA with Tom Vilsack. And it is these plays, agricultural plays that I've been doing for about 10 years have spawned an organization called Ag Arts, which is to promote healthy food systems through the arts. So there's a booth out in the hall. We'll give you a lot more information about that. And right now we're going to have Maria bring us Map of My Kingdom.
Do you know how my grandma Millie sold the farm? I just heard this story a few months ago. Now, I remember getting this out of the blue news from my mom that my grandma sold the farm, but I never heard how she went about doing it until just a while back. And it was only recently that I began to understand why my grandma sold the farm exactly like she did. Carl Huber told me the story. One Saturday morning, when Grandma Millie was around 80 years old, she knocked on his door. His farm was the next one over, and she pulled into his driveway in the 41 Ford, and...
Carl? Carl!
I'm selling the farm, and you're the buyer. She laid out terms. On contract, such and such per acre, real top dollar. And Carl, he's just standing there, not knowing what hit him, and she's all Hurricane Millie, just, Carl? Your father and my father immigrated and homesteaded this land. They farmed side by side for years, and you and I worked together as neighbors all our lives. We've seen a lot of harvest, a lot of threshing crews. And Carl, he's nodding along, but can't get a word in edgewise, and Millie is just, now, you Hubers have always been good farmers, and I know you'll take good care of the land. And then your sons will do the same after you. And Carl told her that the price was a little steep. Hey, fair, but a little steep. And that he didn't really need another farm, and that his boys were already set up. And Millie, I have already had my lawyer drop the papers, and they're all ready. We'll sign them Monday morning with that price. And Carl shook her hand, and she told him, Monday morning, sign the papers. Carl did. And that's what Carl told me, that story a while back. Up until then, I hadn't known the details. My mom had simply received a letter one day. Oh, Grandma sold the farm. My mom was stunned. We all were. No discussion, just a letter that it was sold, that it was gone. My mom had grown up on that farm. I had spent summer vacations there. We were in the city then, but the farm, that was steady, you know, always home. No matter where we were, always there. And then it wasn't. Now, my mom was an only child and had no intention of farming. But still, that had been in our family for nearly a century. I puzzled over that transaction for years. My grandma Millie passed not long after she and Carl shook hands, and I guess I realize now my grandma knew her mind and wasn't about to have anyone change it. No discussion, just a handshake with Carl and this letter. I wondered. I started thinking, how do other families handle these things? I mean, we don't even have a real word for it. Selling the farm, land transfer, and it's not just that. It feels like we don't have a real process for how to do this, let alone do it well. The process has always been difficult. This is one of the reasons my family left Ireland. As the population grew, land was divided into smaller and smaller farms, too small to sustain even a single family. And then the potato, their single crop, failed. And you know that story. There was a story, though, that I followed in the newspaper. I think everyone in the whole state followed the case of these two brothers. And it was just Cain and Abel, you know? I mean, even now, there is still this primal thing when it comes to the land. Now, it was the late 70s, and there was this big push on farmers, get big or get out. Both brothers, Mike and Tim, thought they had it worked out with this old bachelor farmer, close with their parents, almost like he was in the family since he had no family of his own. The brothers both had good-sized operations. The bachelor farmer was in between them with just 80 acres, this old man, small farm, no one to pass it on to. Mike thought the old man was selling the farm to him. Tim, same thing. Both felt that they had a right to the man's farm since it was in the family. Both thought they should inherit the farm and they did not want to wait. Both worried the old man might will it to the other brother, so they were willing to give a good price to get the farm now, not risk it by waiting. The competition for land was just fierce in those days. Farmers scanned obituaries, attended funerals, just so they could approach families to buy farms. The old man, he got so wore out, he took to sitting on his porch with his shotgun each time one of the brothers came around trying to make his case. He'd sit there with his hand on the gun. I'll will the farm to my dogs if you don't leave me be. Okay. So, while the brothers waited for the man to make up his mind, they started to borrow money, investing in expensive machinery, making plans for the land they were sure they would get. The longer they waited, the more expensive this became. Interest rates climbed on their loans, land values were on the rise. Both felt that those acres, just those few acres, and only those acres, could get them out of debt and make them solvent. Now, the brothers worked hard, were regular churchgoers, well-respected members of the community. Mike was that great neighbor, you know, always going to take over another farmer's chores if he got hurt or sick. Tim was on the county board of supervisors, real respected, fair-minded. I mean, they had their differences, right? Mike was a Methodist, Tim a Presbyterian, but other than that. Finally, Tim convinced the old man to let him at least lease the land, and he started to pasture some sheep there. Mike got mad, really mad. Came roaring up, yelling, "Move your sheep off my land!" Tim yelled back, "Get your pickup off my land!" A huge search party formed, about 200 people who spread out over half the county to search for the missing brother. After about 24 hours, they finally found his body. A bullet hole in his head, stuffed into a culvert, all of it covered over with straw. The community just couldn't believe that Mike might have, it had to have been some druggie who just blew through the area. Murders like this just didn't happen here. The whole town, the whole family, some chose to testify to Mike's good character. Others chose to stand for Tim. But it just split them, friends, cousins, sitting in the courtroom facing each other. And the parents, they sat in between the two families, stunned, saying nothing. Mike was charged with first-degree murder. He pleaded not guilty, but the evidence was against him. They found Tim's bloody seed cap in Mike's truck. Mike was convicted and sentenced to life in prison. Both brothers lost their farms. One brother lost his life, or maybe both did in a way. Their wives tried to hold on as long as they could, but the farm crisis had begun in full force, and soon their debts became too much for them. The farms, their livestock, everything the brothers owned was sold at the same auction. I followed that case from the beginning all the way through the end of the trial. And you better believe I began to understand my Grandma Millie just a little bit better. Then, in college, first play we read in sophomore literature, yep, Shakespeare's King Lear. And it was like he understood my Grandma Millie too. Now, King Lear, knowing that his time was drawing near, decided to divide up the map of his kingdom between his three daughters. Give me the map there. Know that we have divided in three our kingdom, and 'tis our fast intent to shape all cares and business from our age, conferring them on younger strengths, while we, unburdened, crawl toward death. Lear decided to offer the largest share to his youngest daughter, Cordelia, whom he loved best. And that's when it all started. Lear's eldest, Goneril, was not about to take that sitting down. Sir, I love you more than word can wield the matter, dearer than eyesight, space, and liberty, beyond what can be valued, rich, or rare. Then Lear's middle daughter, Regan, spoke up. I am of that same self-metal as my sister, and prize me at her worth. In my true heart, I find she names my very deed of love. Only she comes too short. Then Lear turned to his beloved Cordelia expectantly. I love your majesty according to my bond, no more nor less. And Lear was devastated. He disinherited and banished Cordelia and divvied up his kingdom between his two eldest daughters. Now, our professor put this Freudian spin on the play, saw Cordelia as this symbol of death, went on and on how Lear was obviously afraid of his own mortality, so he banished Cordelia, death, from his sight. Lear went into complete denial of his own demise. So the class discussion went on and on how the play was about sex, death wishes, dreams, pun jokes, women's hysteria. Really. You know, I sat there through the whole thing, and here's the deal. Most of the kids in that class hadn't grown up on a farm, but any kid who had any farmer reading Lear could see that the whole problem in the play is this idea of land, how it's passed on, transferred from one generation to the next. Next book we read was Jane Smiley's modern retelling of Lear, 1,000 Acres, and Smiley, whoop, she just nails Lear, all of it. Start to divide up the kingdom. Whatever you got going on in your family, whatever secrets lie just beneath the surface, boom, they'll pop up. All right, take your pick. Incest, adultery, attempted murder, alcoholism, abuse. It's all there waiting for you down at the farm. Now, my mom would send me these little clippings from our hometown newspaper. I've read more and more about the problems with families and farms. And there would be these obituaries. You could tell something was happening, something different. I learned that the suicide rate among farmers is 60 times greater than the national average of other occupations. What was going on? I thought, my God, someone has to help these people. Now, okay, of course there are families and farms that make smooth transitions. But even in those families, it had to have been hard starting that transition, making it concrete, all makes sense. I started to think. I got an advanced degree in psychology, one in counseling, then went to law school. I focused on wills, trusts, estate planning. I studied interpersonal relations, agronomy, economics, this whole mix of things that didn't make sense to anybody, but it made sense to me, to what I wanted to do. I moved back home and became a mediator for land transfer disputes. Believe me, no one could have been more surprised than me by my choice. So, stuck out my shingle and never looked back. You know, reading this, you might wonder what made King Lear even want such a large kingdom. I mean, one he could guess would inevitably lead to some kind of war. Maybe he didn't think it would start in his own family, but... See, for most of the families I started to meet, owning land meant everything. Owning land meant making things better, making good on what their parents did for them, making it better for their kids. A real triumph, generation after generation, over poverty, struggle, servitude. The agrarian imperative. Experts debate this idea all the time. The historical genetic anthropological evidence suggests that those who engage in agriculture are fulfilling the agrarian imperative. A desire to own land and a drive to farm is embedded in their very DNA. Hocus pocus, the desire to own land has to do with monetary pressures. The agrarian imperative instills in farmers the ability to work incredibly hard, to endure unusual pain and hardship, to take uncommon risks. There's a personality type that goes with this. Bunk. A farmer's success has nothing to do with personality or some genetic drive. Success revolves around economic, social, and cultural capital. Nobel Prize winners like Conrad Lorenz have studied the territorial behaviors in birds and mammals. Humans have the same drive to mark out their territory and provide for their families. There's an underlying anxiety that drives them and... Okay. Regardless of what the experts thought, I quickly learned from the families coming through my door what was truly at stake. Well, Dan and I, we have three kids who want to come back and farm. All have agriculture degrees, good farm kids, hard workers. All are interested in taking over the place, but farm, it's surrounded by subdivisions now, and there's no real room to grow. And we're worried about that. Went through the same thing with Dan's folks. We started working, renovating his folks' farm, and when his parents passed, Dan's brother, well, he's kind of got the greedy gene. He contested the will. I mean, we were there working the land, and you know, he's not interested in that. He sees the farm as development land, you know, the subdivisions. Gets this idea, the land is worth something like $40,000 an acre. Won't take agricultural prices. So he sued Dan. Sent out the will for forensic testing, looking at the ink, the signatures, to prove something. Even tried to recruit our neighbors to testify against us that we tricked his parents, I guess. We were in court for 10 years. We eventually settled with him. Six figures. It was about as ugly as we could get. Now, I told my children, I will come back and haunt you from the grave if you try anything like this. And, I mean, we finally got to start farming the land just a little bit ago. You know, I really get to farm it how we've always wanted to. And we're not ready to pet up just yet. And the kids, well, they all have their own ideas of how they want to farm too, which makes sense. It'll probably be up to me to rally the troops when the time comes and I guess interview everybody about how they see it all fitting together for after, you know, the future. Dan and I, we get along pretty good, but whew, there were some times when we were on opposite ends of the spectrum when it comes to the land. Now, I'll read all up on something, go try it. A few acres of organic vegetables, a chicken tractor filled with poultry, started a small CSA, things like that. I'd ask Dan, what are we leaving to our children? And Dan would say, piece of expensive farmland. Well, all that expensive farmland is washing down to the Gulf of Mexico. And Dan would just, well, the Roman Empire wore out their soil, Dan. And Dan would just say, I am trying to make a living right now, right here, without having to fix the whole damn Roman Empire. And I am telling him, I mean, this soil, is a global treasure. Plus our kids' heritage, our retirement too. This soil, we are truly blessed. And if we keep putting all this ticky-tack on top of it, or, you know, don't do enough to, I mean, we are not only screwing up the soil. We're screwing up the water. We are screwing up the air. We are screwing up something of our children's, too. We tried to come up with a mission statement for the farm. Ooh, that is hard. You know? I mean, that's your home. A mission statement for where you live. I told my kids, if nothing changes, the day would come when they would have to start carving up the farm. I see it coming. I'm not going to, you know, rule my kids from the grave, but I will come back and give them a good visit if they misbehave. We often act like women aren't involved in land decisions. We think it's fathers who ask, well, how do I divide the land among my sons? But death, divorce, maybe us paying a little better attention, make it clear this isn't just an issue between fathers and sons anymore. Probably never was, really. I mean, King Lear divided up his kingdom among his daughters. It's a family thing. Back in college, right here, Willa Cather's O Pioneers. We come and we go, but the land is always here. And the people who love it and understand it are the people who own it for a little while. Only for a little while. Willa Cather was writing about the same things, the same issues I was seeing coming into my office. Native Americans had little sense of land ownership. What is this you call property? Massasoit asked the early settlers of Plymouth Colony. It cannot be the earth, for the land is our mother, nourishing all her children, the beasts, birds, fish, and all men. The woods, the streams, everything on it belongs to everybody. How can one man say it belongs only to him? But then the Europeans came and superimposed a Jeffersonian grid on top of the land and introduced individual property rights. Easier to get to market with a great system of roads, that's for sure. But the grid partitioned off, isolated family farms, every family on a farm. In the communal model, issues with the land were figured out together. In the European model, you were on your own to solve problems. Even if the farm up the road or across the section was facing the same problems, the same crisis, asking the same questions. And a lot of times, these problems kept repeating themselves, generation to generation, family to family, farm to farm. A while back, I went and saw my own family's farm in Ireland, and all this clicked for me. I looked out over the land with my cousin, and she told me this story. The ancestral farm was 80 acres, but pure rock, okay? Only 20 acres were actually tillable. And that soil, that 20 acres of arable turf, they cut that up for fuel and literally burnt through all their farmland. So, the farmers got an idea. They went down to the ocean, and they hauled up these large baskets of seaweed and kelp from the beach and laid them out across the rocks and barren scars. Now, after years and years of composting what they were pulling out of the ocean, that soil became tillable. And when my ancestors came here, they actually had great soil, but they burned through it just the same. And when the Dust Bowl came, let's just say there wasn't a lot of seaweed here. See, Native Americans viewed all land, all creation as sacred. My ancestors, they read the Bible and read there in Genesis that God created heaven and earth to benefit all of humanity. But it also says in Leviticus that the land shall not be sold in perpetuity, for the land is mine. For you are strangers and sojourners with me. By grace, not by right, God has entrusted his land to humans who need to be good stewards of this gift. The land, these issues, they're in Shakespeare, in the Bible, and all kinds of other sacred texts, too. The Quran says that property should not be gained by unlawful means, that its acquisition and continuity should not damage others, and that this acquisition should not invalidate a valid claim. Well, the experts say, agriculture is the mother of all civilization. It provided leisure time to develop the arts. Bunk. Agriculture did nothing but deplete the soil, which became the downfall of all civilizations. Agriculture allowed people to become stationary, to live in cities, to develop concepts of government. Where people developed hierarchical societies that mistreated women and children. Agriculture provided the basis for science, math, engineering. Religious traditions and rituals grew out of agriculture's rich symbolism. The shepherd and his flock, etc., etc. The Bible is rife with motifs of agricultural metaphor. My grandma Millie, she knew two jokes. That's right, only two. She'd tell them over and over, same two jokes as long as I knew her. And one of these jokes had to do with these so-called motifs of agricultural metaphor. Okay, but dealt with it probably a little better than the experts. At least for my grandma Millie, it did. You could always tell the joke was coming because she would lean back, look up, as if she were remembering some long lost knowledge that it was vital for her to impart to you right then, right there. You know, once I saw this enthusiastic young preacher come upon this farmer working in his field. Now, this young man was deeply concerned for this farmer's soul. So the pup preacher, he asked the farmer, "Are you laboring in the vineyard of the Lord, my good man?" And the farmer, well, he looks at the preacher, he looks at the field. Nah, these are soybeans. Yeah, we were polite enough to laugh or at least chuckle every time. Now, these motifs of agricultural metaphor were not beyond Millie. No, she was sharp as a tack. But folks don't often have a lot of use for some metaphorical prodigal son story, especially when their own family is literally being pulled apart by one. Molly's mother had passed a few years back, and her father wasn't in the best of health. He had, a stroke, diabetes, and this aggressive onset of congestive heart failure, which was limiting blood flow to his brain. It wasn't dementia exactly. He would be lucid for small stretches of time, and then his body would have to shut down, reboot. The farm was worth millions, and the father did not want to sell it. He had two children, a daughter, Molly, still on the farm, living there with her husband, taking care of the dad, and a son, Molly's younger brother, Larry. Larry had made a lot of money in restaurants and then lost it, all of it. Came back to the farm and, you know the story, prodigal son, asked for his inheritance. And there's also the story of Jacob here too, tricking his father Isaac into blessing him, the youngest son, and stealing the birthright of his elder brother Esau. Unbeknownst to his sister Molly, Larry convinced his dad to let him change the will. Larry saw how much money he could make when they finally sold the farm, and he started driving a Cadillac, taking jet-setting vacations, flashing fancy rings on his fingers. Molly and her husband started to question what was going on. They went to Dad, but he became confused, angry. His health was declining. Molly was worried about Alzheimer's, something not right with Dad. Then, one day, Larry and his big Cadillac got into this huge fight with Molly's husband, started over something small and built to Larry shouting, "You and Molly won't be on the farm for long." The fights continued to escalate, Dad's health continued to deteriorate, and finally Molly called me. She was so worried that one of the three men would try to kill the others, she took all the guns out of the house and hid them. Another mediator and I met the whole family in a hotel suite 50 miles from the farm, a neutral location. We had Dad in one room, Larry in another, Molly and her husband in a third. My partner stayed with Dad, tried to keep him on track and calm, while I ran back and forth between the siblings. Separate rooms did not help. They started screaming at each other through the walls. Dad yelled, banging on the thin hotel walls with his cane, "I don't need to take this. Get out of my goddamn sight." Then Larry shouted, "I am out of your sight." And Molly's husband, "Shut up, just shut up, the two of you." And Dad, "Oh, go to hell." So, I decided to try this. Any time that we sat down to talk about the farm, I showed them how to conduct a formal business meeting. Take minutes, use Robert's rules of order. We were making progress, real progress. And then the father passed away. At the reading of the will, everything came to light. Larry had convinced his father to name him sole beneficiary of the land, all of it worth millions, changing the will without Molly or her husband knowing, and cutting them out completely. And that's when it all started. Lawyers for Molly went back and looked at the books. Not only had her younger brother secretly changed the will, Larry had been siphoning off money, borrowing against his inheritance for years before the father passed. Bought that Cadillac, built a $500,000 house. Larry showed up at the farm to Molly to clear out. It was all his now. They went to court and stayed there for a decade. Molly and her husband kept losing. The will, the father's health, Larry's deception, all complicated things. Molly appealed and appealed, and at one point, I was called to the stand to give my professional opinion of the father's state of mind. Yes, I worked with the family as a mediator before the father's death. My expertise is not in ascertaining the father's mental capability. I can only give a opinion, not a professional. No. No, I can't honestly, with absolute certainty, say that the father was incapable of making a rational decision during the period that he was my client. The courts upheld the father's will all the way up the line. The family deception and dishonesty were brought to light in each trial, but each time, the judge chose to honor the father's will as the legally binding document. Each judge made the same decision, all the way up to our state Supreme Court. The family will probably never be on speaking terms the rest of their lives. Molly has come to terms with it, says she wants to be a better person, not a bitter person, that this is a learning experience. She and her husband live in town now. They're doing all right. They're doing okay. Grandma Millie's second joke went like this. Now, you could tell it was coming because she'd get that same look and lean back and then, you know, tell a story about that same anonymous farmer and that same anonymous field. You know, once I saw this salesman drive up to this farmer working in his field. Now, this salesman was about to get out of his big old fancy car when he sees this big old dog sitting there over in the end rows there. Salesman, he hollers at the farmer, "Hey, mister, your dog bite?" Farmer, he goes, "No." So, salesman gets out of his car and boom, dog runs up, bites him in the leg. Salesman jumps on top of his car, "Hey, I thought you said your dog didn't bite." Farmer, he goes, "That's not my dog." Grandma Millie, two joke comedian. And you know what? For a lot of the families I worked with, they would be just like that farmer in the joke. "That's not my dog." But unlike him, they'd be the ones getting bit. See, the joke had it wrong. It was their dog. It was their problem. And it was them who were going to end up getting bit, not some salesman in a big fancy car. I mean, it happened to Lear. You know, he tried to simply pass off his land to his daughters, and he ended up getting bit. And in his madness, he says, "Little dogs and all, Trey, Blanche, and Sweetheart, see, they bark at me." Okay, I know. Maybe a little much when talking about metaphors and madness, right? But it seems real enough to the families when it happens to them, when it starts to fall apart. But sometimes there's a family that finds its way. Sometimes I help, but believe it or not, I am learning to help more and more. I had known Marilyn and Jerry for a long time. They had a large farm, really thriving. They survived the farm crisis, grew responsibly, were well-respected members of the community. I was surprised when they came into my office. For a year, Jerry had worked with his lawyer, accountant, and a consultant to make a plan for his land when he and Marilyn stopped farming, or if anything happened. Jerry had reached this place where he and Marilyn had digested everything the lawyer, accountant, and consultant had suggested. Then they set up a meeting with me. Jerry and Marilyn, they had everything in order, the books, the abstracts. They had asked tough questions and were working those out together. They worked on a mission statement, a plan for the land, and got their kids and family on board. It had seemed easy. I didn't realize how hard they had worked, how hard they had worked to make it seem easy, until Marilyn came into my office a few weeks after Jerry passed to put that plan we had made together into motion. Marilyn came in exhausted from the funeral and those lonely weeks after. All that work tying up loose ends, all that work that nobody ever sees, all that work that leaves little time for doing, let alone feeling anything else. Marilyn came in, I put on the coffee, and we just sat. And Marilyn told me this story. I went to see the Pope once. Never thought that would be something I'd want to do, not Catholic, you know? But the Pope, he was traveling across the states, visiting churches, you know, blessing people. And I got this idea that I was going. This is what I was going to do, see the Pope. Jerry, he was busy, you know, not interested, but said, go on, you know, knock myself out with the Pope. Anyways, I drove into the city and people everywhere. And he drove up in that that Pope-mobile, and people, they just start waving and hollering. You know, he's there in that little aquarium, and you know, you put your hand up in the air, and he looked at me, and I felt like he was saying hi right to me, and I just start waving, hollering, whistling. I mean, I never got to see the Beatles or Elvis, so I guess I got it all out of my system with that Pope. Anyways, we sit on these bleachers, you know, settle in, getting ready to hear the Pope. And Jerry, he was at home on the farm, painting in the barn, and I guess he turned on the radio and they were broadcasting the Pope. And, you know, I'm sitting on these bleachers, Jerry's on the farm, but we're both listening to what this guy had to say. And why is some guy from Rome in the fancy robe gonna have for us? You know, me on the bleachers, Jerry on the farm? Really? So the Pope started to talk, and I was looking around at all these people, and Jerry must have been painting, not listening much. And then the Pope started talking about the need to be stewards of the land, how we are called to leave the earth, the soil, a better condition than we found it. The land is yours to preserve from generation to generation. And that hit me. Hit Jerry too. I started crying right there, the Pope talking and tears running down my face. I got home that night and Jerry was just sitting there. No, how was it? Nothing, just sitting. Hands folded, thinking. Jerry, I said. And he reached out and took my hands. Jerry said he about fell off the ladder when the Pope started talking about the land. You know, Jerry started thinking about our kids and what we were leaving them and how we were leaving the farm to them. And I said, me too. Pope's speech did the same thing to me. And we just sat there for a bit, thinking. And then we got up, cooked dinner, and did. They figured out a way to communicate to their kids what they valued and hoped for the land going forward. Everybody signed off on the plan, no surprises. One son would stay on, farm the land while renting from his siblings. Jerry had him build a house down the road, far enough away so that he couldn't see Jerry and Marilyn's farmstead. Jerry figured this would keep him from trying to meddle in how his son was starting to farm and keep his son from trying to fix what he thought Jerry was doing wrong. And that wasn't really the fix, you know? It just got the issue out in the open, got them talking about it, Jerry and his son. And they figured it out as they went, right up until Jerry passed. It wasn't easy. But I learned that day how hard they had worked, how much honesty and courage it took to make it look like it was. I think about Millie's jokes about Lear. Many a true word hath been spoken in jest, or here, how sharper than a serpent's tooth to have a thankless child. I think about Jerry, I think about Marilyn and all the other families coming through my door trying to figure out how their shared story with their land will change. Sometimes they have time to prepare. Men must endure. They're going hence even as they're coming hither. But a lot of times, families don't have time to prepare. You know, like Lear, they are facing down a storm, standing in the middle, not really sure what to do next. You know, like Millie's joke, they are looking at a mean old dog. They are pretty sure bites. And if they're lucky, they'll face it like Jerry and Marilyn. They'll realize nothing can come from nothing. So they'll start to do something. So when the time comes to give me the map there, know that we have divided in three our kingdom, and 'tis our fast intent to shake all cares and business from our age, conferring them on younger strengths. Grandma Millie read this book. Maybe if Lear had read Willa Cather like Millie had. We come and we go, but the land is always here. And the people who love it and understand it are the people who own it for a little while. It's a tough conversation on how we end our own little while with the land. Let somebody else's little while start. We come and we go, but the land is always here. And the people who love it and understand it. We only have this little sliver of time to make sure the land keeps getting loved, keeps getting understood, one while after the other. Thank you.
Professionals into
no, it's been amazing. The audience is right. Yeah, the rural, the urban.
The city is where we get somebody that will put King Lear in there.
No, that's right. I've had comments from farmers like a play. They told me I was going to see a play before I start talking about my estate planning. I don't know. I thought I'd just turn off my hearing aid. But by golly, I listened to every single word because I saw myself in that show. So yeah, so we're doing that. And then, you know, on another level, they, you know, plays work on levels, as even the set works on levels. So I was hoping that, you know, I would. I meet farmer on a certain level, and then the intellectual on a certain level with the play. We've done the show for major meetings of lawyers, and they look at it in a whole different regard, you know, than creative writers would or farmers would. So everybody has their.
How long did it take you to write the play?
It took way longer to research the play. The play is a combination of my own experience. I went through this with my own family farm and my family, and it just blew the family apart for about 5 years. And then I have a tiny little farm myself now, so I've had to do that planning myself. And then it was historical research, you know, book research. And then Practical Farmers of Iowa sent me hither and yon all across the state interviewing farmers and bankers and lawyers. And so it took about a year to do all of that research, and then it took a month, which doesn't sound like a long time, but it was like 8-hour days to come up with the script. And then the hard work begins, because then you get a critique of the script, and there are rewrites and more rewrites, and then we go into rehearsals, and all of that production stuff takes months to do. So yeah, so the whole thing was about a year. Yeah, over there.
Could you talk about some of the community or family conversations that have ensued following people watching this?
I'm trying to hear, the conversations following the show?
Yes.
Yeah. It's really interesting. I mean, one of the first times we did the show, we did it in the Makokada Art Experience, which is the founders are here. And, you know, I'm not part of that community, so you just kind of waltz into the community. And then afterwards, somebody in Makokada said, wow, that was really interesting. See that guy over there? He was in the front row. See that guy over there? He was in the back row. Those are brothers, and they haven't spoken to each other for 30 years because it was a farmland transition issue. So people started, like that, started speaking to each other. I was in a church basement with a table of eight widows, all in their 80s, and not one of them had a will. And they started talking about, well, geez, I guess it's about time, you know, to do something. So it's been amazing like that. One man got up, we did a show in Decorah, and one man got his another barn, and he got up, and there were just tears streaming down his face, and he said, you got a video of this? And we do, actually. If you go to my website, you can purchase a copy of a video of Map of My Kingdom. It's just maryswander.com, and I said, that's coming, Mike. Give me a few months. That video is coming. He said, well, when's that video coming out? And I said, no, it's a couple months. And he said, oh, no, that's too late. And I'm like, what is going on here? He said, just send me the script. Well, send me 6 copies of the script. I'm like, yeah, well, I'm happy to send you the script. We can do 6 copies of the script, Mike. He goes, you know, I'm going to send it to every one of my kids, and it is required reading before Thanksgiving. That's when we're all going to sit down and talk about how we're going to divvy up the farm.
You know, if I can just plug, I do have, I think, 5 copies of the film, if anyone is curious. They don't want to deal with the website. So that's one thing, too.
Oh, yeah, you've got some copies.
I think about 5 copies of the DVD.
Okay. Okay, great. We've got real live DVDs here. Yep, over there.
Yeah, I grew up in an agricultural community. My grandparents, great-grandparents, my family, they were farm workers. And so they worked for the property owners. And I currently now work with farm working communities that make $15,000, $20,000 a year for family four or five. And I hear in the play a great love and stewardship for the soil. And I'm wondering, in regards to this property conversation, for those who weren't privileged with that, to have that property conversation, how does the conversation of stewardship to your fellow man and woman in the community that is making the farm successful, how does that conversation play out in estate planning, in the community conversations? And that's what I'm really interested in hearing.
In the stewardship of the people, in the people involved in the actual farming? Well, these people actually—they farm their own properties. Most of them that you see there, and they—you know—the stewardship there is the integrity of the family. This is an issue that just rips families apart. I mean, believe me, had that happen in my own family, and so that's why we're urging people to take the time to do this. And I think the best story I heard about this was. Wonderful lawyer down in Southwest Iowa, and she really specializes in this. And she said, you know, the way I was taught in law school is the person comes in, we drop the will, and that's that. And then the person dies, and I bring in the offspring, and I read them the will, and then they fight it out. Yeah. And she said, so one day this woman came in her 80s, and she said, you know, here's what I want, and I want you to gather my whole family together, and we're going to discuss this with you here in the room. And the lawyer was like, no, that's not the way it's done. That's what the way we do it. And the woman insisted. And she brought in the whole family, and they had a discussion, worked out the details. 5 years later, the mother died, and the kids were all okay, in place around this. And she said, that's the way I've worked it from then on. That's the way to do it. I actually have another play, too, called Bang. And it's about recent immigrant farmers. And that's a show where you see immigrants hiring other immigrants to work on the farm. And so some of those issues, I think, that you're touching on, too, come up there, where they're not landowners, but they are doing the farming. And there are a lot of information there about how we treat those people and what expectations we have of those people and their connection to the land, their connection to the land in their countries. So it's good. Yeah.
I was just thinking on that topic in our family, it's like very typical farm situation where my parents farm the land. That's where the stewardship in our land went.
Right.
So it's a very common story in Iowa, in the Midwest, anyway, that the stewardship lacks when someone else is farming it.
Right.
So that is what was the intention in our family, how to deal with that.
Right.
So even though we have the love of land, that topic in particular can be very
touchy. Yeah.
Touchy of how to recover or what's wrong with leasing them out. You know,
right.
When you think about the quality of the land and what it means in the long
right.
term.
A lot of these farm organizations are trying to address that very issue. One of the big conflicts that comes out is that 50% of the farmland in Iowa, and I'm sure it's similar in other states, is owned by women. And oftentimes, it'll be leased out like that. And the farm owner, the woman, wants to keep the land in, you know, the integrity of the land in good shape. And then, you know, the farmer that's leasing it has a different kind of investment in it. So Women Food and Agriculture Network has a program addressing that very thing. Yeah. Over here.
Yeah, on that note, I was really happy to hear
some
of the conversation around women in farming. And I went through this with my family. After my grandfather died, my grandmother sold our farm.
Right.
And so, and I feel that that happened a lot in our community, that, you know, it, the girls are just sort of, you're not even asked about it, and now,
hey,
you know, 15 years later, I'm like, I really would have loved to stay in that conversation.
Absolutely, absolutely. That,
it's an issue that I'm happy to hear you're talking
about. No, and that has a lot to do with your family mindset, your ethnicity. You know, we were up in north central Iowa, a lot of German communities, Scandinavian communities, and, you know, women my age came up and said, I got chipped out of it because I was the girl. You know, really, really still angry about that. And, you know, now the whole thing's turning around. But, you know, I think the majority of beginning farmers are now women. And you know, they're doing a whole new thing. With small farms and vegetable production, small livestock, those kinds of things. And so, you know, it's time that we look at that and rethink. We don't just, you know, automatically give it to the oldest boy. I live in the middle of the Amish settlement down by Kelowna, and their tradition is really interesting to watch. It's the youngest who gets the farm. Often a boy, but sometimes the girl. And then they also get, the youngest gets the farm and the elder care responsibility for the parents.
And is it biblically related?
Could be, yeah, I'm not sure.
A lot of stories, what the youngest is supposed to get it ends up with it.
Right, right. So, you know, I worked with a woman, this was in Decorah again, she was a financial advisor, actually, so she had her head together. She had a farm. She was a widow. She wanted to move into town. She wrote a letter to all of her four kids and said, all right, it's time to make the transition. Or do any of you want to farm? If not, I want you to get together, even if there's one that does, I want you to get together and figure out how we're going to make this transition. And they did it really smoothly. I thought, wow, that's interesting. It wasn't just like the authority figure saying, here's how we're going to do it, kids. So she involved them. Yeah, way back in the back there.
Thank you for this. It really struck a chord with me because this will be my life at some point with both siblings and some cousins. And the stories that you are all the parents and how the parents start the conversation. How do the, and you just mentioned this, how do the offspring, if they're the ones that want to start the conversation with the parents, how do they do that?
Yeah, I think it's, you know, a good thing for offspring to try to bring it up. Just don't bring it up like on a major holiday. And I think that mother that said, got all four kids together, you know, in the same room at once to bring it up, it's really good. Like, one, you know, starts bringing it up, then the other just gets, like, nervous and everything. So they bring them together and everybody discuss it for the first time. You know, together maybe mid-September or something.
So I think this is beautiful. I think you've identified the complexity of this. There's also a huge expense that's not just emotional. It's not just about familial things happening. There's a cost.
I'm having a hard time here.
There's a cost that goes with this as
right.
well. I mean, an expense if you're going to work on this. And so you talked about this being a problem with your siblings. I mean, if you, the other thing is sometimes people never say to their parents or their siblings, I think I want to live on the farm.
Right.
Even if they've gone away from it, even if they've done other things, that desire is often like held in some weird place because it seems inappropriate to bring it up.
Right.
And people might have disdain for you because of that if you have siblings, or they might have a completely different idea of what that family landscape is.
Right.
And so, I think, I mean, again, this is incredibly beautiful, and it's exactly to the point.
Right.
The difficulty
right.
of this,
right.
and again, if you're going to do this, you're going to pay for it.
Yeah, that's
and
right.
pay for it in trying to figure out how your family should work while your parents are alive, when they're dead, who's
right.
left over, who thinks the territory belongs to them, who wants money, who doesn't want money. I mean, that value system in your family is displayed in the most accurate and hideous and beautiful way,
right.
but you're going to pay for it, and it's going to take some time. If you're interested in owning your family farm, don't wait till your parents are going to die 3 months from then.
Exactly.
Think about it now. and talk about those things in a way that will get you to a place that will be hard and you'll pay, but you might get a thing that you think you desire and it can work out. You know, you've talked about easy transitions.
Okay.
Talking about money and land are, and then religion might be the other one.
And death.
And death. Those are the things that people never want to talk about.
That's it.
And yet it's part of living on a farm and being in the world in a way that's presented to us all the time. So,
again,
thank you for that. That's really wonderful to hear. And I was going to say, I'm also the booking agent for Mary, too.
Right.
My name's Maria Voorhees. So, you know, if we go to all kinds of spaces. We go to conferences, like Mary said, you know, churches, wherever. So if people are interested, you know, this show, I think, really does work word of mouth. So we have, I don't know if you've seen it, we have a little booth out here. Mary also, like she said, has an immigrant show. So please pick up a card with my name on it, Mary's name on it, and we'll be in touch too.
Yep, great. Maybe one or two more questions here. Yeah, Kiko.
One of the messages I hear underlying in this piece is how limiting the system of private ownership of land is, right? Not only on kind of this practical level of how people have to work through the legal system to pass on, but we can also think about that in the history of race, colonialism, and racism, where people were denied access to even owning land. So I'm just curious, as this piece of art has spawned conversation, has there been any conversation about alternative models that don't rely on private ownership? Public ownership, cooperative ownership.
Yeah, we've had a lot of response to that, and it depends on the audience. But we did the show in Dubuque for the Catholic Worker Farm, sponsored us up there, a great group of people, and I opened up, you know, for questions like this. And the first person got up and said, "Well, all right, so we stole this land from the natives, so why don't you give it all back?" which wasn't so crazy. Then people started coming forward, and their various trusts and co-ops and foundations were beginning Native farmers, beginning other farmers, their ways, their Pregnant Farmers of Iowa has a branch of their group that helps you, guide you through this, where you can work with a beginning farmer to transfer your land. There are a variety of things, community foundations, there are nature people that have given their land for nature preserves, all sorts of very alternative things where people are completely thinking out of the box of the norm that you saw, you know, that you see on the stage. So that's been really fun and interesting. For people to come forward with their ideas like that. Yeah, Kevin?
I just want to ask back with the farming, since, you know, I grew up on a farm where as a small child, you're like a business partner / employee.
Yeah.
So there's a part of with my parents, it's like, well, that's whatever you want to do, that's your thing. But part of it's like, well, I'm not, this is something you have a different relationship with.
It's a business too, right?
Right.
One of the most difficult things is when, you know, say there's many siblings and one stays on the farm and puts in all that sweat equity, and then the others are off living in California, and then they come back and see, oh wow, look at this, like Des Moines is sprawling out here, we can sell this for commercial value, and then, you know, the on-farm offspring often has real trouble in that situation, yeah. But there are ways even to deal with that, you know, and what I've learned from this is, as was said, get going on it right away, start thinking about it. Not all of us are involved in family farms, but we all own something, most of us. And start thinking about your transition before it's a crisis or an emergency. Give it some real, real thought. And what I did was, do some actual research and read up on it, and I really meditated on this and did some discernment. Then I went into the lawyer, you know, because you don't want to go in there where the meter is ticking, you know, the billable hours are ticking, saying, hey, what should I do? And so do some research of your own, talk to people, other people's plans, look at some of these alternatives,
and then come up with your own ideas that you know might be modified this way or that. Okay, thank you so much.
Take a ride.